All right, so moving on to chapter 3, section 2. So now we're talking all about heat. So we mentioned it in the last section. We did find out that heat was a form of energy. So now we're going to talk just a little bit more in detail about heat in terms of earth science. So heat is a form of energy caused by the motion of atoms. So when atoms are moving, they have heat to them. So when we talk about heat, it's not the same as temperature. So I know that sometimes we kind of think of both of them as the same thing. Temperature, when we look at it mathematically, is what we call the average of all of the kinetic energy of particles. Heat is the sum. And think about what the difference of that is. Remember in math class, what does that mean if we do sum? Sum means you're adding them all up. So heat is the sum of the kinetic energy of each atom in a sample. So if you look at the picture here on the right-hand side, we have atoms in a hot object, and you can see that quite a few of the arrows have larger links to them. So that would be a hot object, because on average, when I look at all of those, if I sum them up, if I added them up, that's going to be hot. In the bottom there, that would be atoms in a cold object. So even though some are a little bit shorter, some are longer, if you add them up, it still isn't going to be a large amount. So heat is the sum of the kinetic energy of each atom in a sample. Whereas temperature is the average. Temperature is the average of all of those, what it turns out to be. So a thermometer, we talked about those in the last chapter. Really all a thermometer is doing is measuring the average kinetic energy of the atoms. So if you are taking your temperature with a thermometer, you're measuring the average kinetic energy of the atoms inside your body. So heat, kind of an interesting thing. If you looked at what would be the best method for heating the pool. So let's say we have a pool, and if you live out in the country, you've maybe been perplexed with this before, because, you know, I have a well at my house and I go to, you know, fill something up and the water is cold for quite some time. So you think about, okay, what would be the quickest way to warm it up? So water is really cold. So what if I have a teacup full of 100 degrees Celsius water, and now I have a bucket. The water is only 50 degrees Celsius, but I have much, much more water. So you think about what's going to cause that pool to warm up faster. It's going to be the bucket. And it's not because the water's hotter, because it's not hotter. You are just now going to have more particles. When you add them all up, the sum is going to be hotter. So we have three different ways that we can transfer heat. And this is the first one. It is conduction. So conduction is the transfer of heat by the direct contact of atoms and molecules and solids. I almost showed a caps lock, direct contact there. And that's what that is, direct contact. In order for heat transfer to be conduction, it has got to be direct contact. Even just yesterday, I made some hot tea in the house. I put my spoon in there. I walked away for a little bit because it was obviously super hot. I come back and I'm like, ouch, I touched my spoon. I forgot. Even me being your science teacher, oh yeah, conduction. Really, really hot. So when you take that spoon and you put it in the hot cocoa, those atoms are moving really, really fast. And remember, like we said earlier, you're going to transfer from fast to slow. So those molecules moving really fast in the hot cocoa are going to go to the molecules that are moving slower in the cold spoon and get them to move faster as well. And then that heat is going to essentially go up the cold spoon. So that is direct contact, because the spoon is inside the hot cocoa and they are touching each other. Radiation is heat transfer through empty space. This is how we get heat on Earth here from the sun. So sun radiates heat through space to the Earth. Now, the important thing about radiation that's different than conduction is radiation occurs in a vacuum. And that's what space is. And by vacuum, we're saying there's nothing there. There's nothing there. There's not even molecules of any kind. And that's a really important thing, because if that didn't happen, then we wouldn't have any heat on Earth here from the sun. So we cannot transfer heat through a vacuum. So when you think about, there's a lot of things that we use in our daily life. So we try to keep substances warmer for longer. We use vacuums to that advantage. If you look at a cup, like an insulated cup, like a Yeti cup, really all they've done is create a vacuum inside of there. Because if those hot molecules don't have anywhere to transfer that heat to, it's essentially going to stay hot longer. So conduction, an example of conduction, I should go back a second. That would be like, let's say you stepped on a hot sidewalk in the summertime. You stepped on your driveway. You sat on your car seat and it was really hot. You touch a hot pan. All of those would be transferred by conduction, because it's direct contact. Radiation examples would be like, I'm standing outside the yard and I feel the warm sun on my face. I'm sitting by a campfire and I feel my hands getting warm if I kind of hold my hands out and I feel that heat coming off the campfire. So whereas conduction is direct contact, radiation would be through empty space or through the air. And that is how we on Earth get our heat transferred to us. So heat transfer by radiation occurs without direct contact or movement of atoms. Finally, our last way is convection, and you may have heard of this before. Maybe you have a convection oven in your house. The difference between a convection oven and a regular oven is they have a fan inside of it. So convection is the transfer of heat through the motion of gases and liquids. This is a really important earth science process. We talk about this all the time because it's a driving force in weather. It's a driving force in ocean currents that we talk about. But convection occurs because of motion of gases and liquids. So just like in that convection oven that you may have, and you're going to be blowing air in the oven and moving those hot molecules throughout the oven, the same thing can happen outside. When the ground gets heated up by the sun, you can have those molecules get moving faster. And then what happens is when they get moving faster, they actually become less dense and they will rise up in the air. And then as they move up in the air, they can get cooler because it's cooler in the atmosphere. They come together, become more dense, and then they sink. So you get this circulation process of convection. If you have a radiator in your house, which a lot of you may do, we have them in the school here, you have warm water going through pipes and it's heating up the air. And then that warm air is going to rise up because it's less dense. It's going to move throughout the room. You're going to feel it. That is convection. So warm air tends to rise and cold air tends to sink. And it has to do all with density, which we're going to talk about in the next chapter. But it's a really important concept to remember. So warm air rises, cool air sinks. And that's why some of us have ceiling fans in our house. And even though it may seem crazy, we may turn them on in the wintertime and you reverse them. And it's not because you're cold, it's because it's taking that warm air that's been collected near the ceiling and it's going to be pushing it down to the lower part of your room. You're just kind of helping that natural convection process to speed up. Your book talks a little bit about how birds will take advantage of this. So they take a ride on these updrafts. So as that warm air rises up in the atmosphere, they'll catch a ride on it and essentially not have to do any work flying around, which if you're a bird is a good thing because then that means you're eating less food, right? So here's a picture just kind of walking us through those three processes. So if I take a pan and I heat it up over a campfire, in the pan, we are going to have the bottom of the pan as it gets hot, it's going to heat the water up that's directly touching it. That would be conduction. So please remember conduction is direct contact. As that water gets warm, it's going to rise up, it's going to get cool, and then it's going to sink. If any of us have ever made a pan of noodles before, you see this happening. You see the noodles kind of start circulating in the pan. So that warm water is going to rise, cool off, and then it's going to sink. So that's convection because we have circulation. So anytime you guys see that sort of circle of arrows or you see the motion, that's going to be convection. Finally, the pan is getting heated through radiation because you have the campfire there heating up the wood there and then essentially going to heat the pan up later on. So those are our three major types of heat transfer: conduction, convection, and radiation, on how heat gets transferred on Earth or essentially anywhere in the universe. And you just got to kind of remember the basic things. So conduction is direct contact, convection is motion, radiation is just through the air. So really not a lot you have to remember, just kind of those basic things, and it's really that easy.